So good day, everyone. Okay, I think to start with, we had a class last week and we couldn't finish. So we decided to have the second part today. And once again, I would like to apologize for the slight issues we had last week before starting due to machine issues. So without wasting time, I would go into the second part of today's class. And hopefully, I intend to finish the class today, which is chapter 21, and that's iteration. And then we can move on to the, I think, last two sections of the book. And then we'll be done with R for data science. Once again, good day, everyone. I'm Adeyemi Olusola. So today I'll be starting from the map functions. Last week we started with iteration, and one of the reasons why we are in this chapter is to reduce duplication. And then we learned about the loop, and then we also had to look at loop variations, that's the for loop and the while loop. And then the structure of a loop, how it looks like, the body, the structure, and the output. And then how it's, you know, how you iterate over, you know, a certain function or a certain activity, and then how you can reduce it to carry out what it's expected. Then we looked at the second aspect, which is we have the imperative programming, and then we have the functional programming, and then we looked at the other aspect, yeah, in a way. However, today I'll be starting with the map functions, and then we'll look at what the map function does, how it's applied, the structure, and then what we can use it to do. So here we are, that's under section 21.5. So the pattern of looping over a vector, that's when you are doing something to each element and saving the result, you know, is something common with the poor R package, which is one of the packages embedded here, and which is one of the packages that is strictly being used for this mapping function. And the poor package provides a family of functions to do, you know, that pattern of looping by vector for us. There's a function for each type of output, output here being the list, output here being the logical vector, the integer, the double, and the character vector. So if you want to make a list, you just have the map function, and then you put the elements within here, and then you run the command, and you have your output. Likewise, if you want to make a logical vector, ditto for integer, ditto for double vector, and then for character. Okay, so for each function takes a vector as input, we shouldn't forget that, and applies a function to each piece, and then returns a new vector as the output and all that. So, but it's expected that once we master this function, now it will take less time for us to solve over iteration problems. But like it's been said in the book, we shouldn't feel awful for, you know, for learning, you know, how to loop instead of how to map. Because yes, they could do the same thing. But I think the most important thing is for us to be parsimonious about what you are doing, and for us to be able to do whatever it is we want to do, you know, in a concise manner, and then for us to write, you know, our codes elegantly. So either you are using the mapping function or you are using the loop function. I think the basic idea is that you are not copying and pasting the activity you want to do. You've been able to reduce it, and you've been able to make it concise. So, however, some people would tell, you know, would say it's good to avoid loops because they are slow. But here we are made to know that, you know, that's not the case. The chief benefit of using functions like map is not really about their speed, but about their clarity. And it's also because they make our code easier to write and to read. Now, here is a typical example of how this is performed. So we have the map double vector. Then we have the x, which is here, the df. And then this is the command, or the another function, which is the mean. So it performs the mean, you know, for this data frame or this table. And then we have the output here, ditto here for the median, and then for the standard deviation. Now we can compare this one to the loop that we made, you know, earlier on. And then would notice the difference. But we can also pipe, which is something we've also learned. That's the data frame. We can also pipe it, and then we have this, and then we have the mean. It's still going to give us the same thing. Now, there are a few differences between using the mapping and the core summary, which is what we saw last week. It is mentioned that all POR functions are implemented in C, which makes them a little bit faster and maybe also readable. The second argument is the .f, the function to apply. And it can be a formula, a character, or an integer, but we'll learn about this subsequently now. Okay, so this is another function being introduced there, which is the trim. And here we have mapdbl, we have the table or the data frame, we have the function to carry out the mean, and then we have the trim 0.5. Initially, I thought this trim should be maybe the decimal, the significant figures or something, but I couldn't really get to that before this section, the third time where I was ready to come on to start. So, but I'll still check it. But if anyone can provide that, that would be nice. So the map function also preserves names, you know, something like this. You have a list here. And then you can ask it to map the integer z based on the length, and then it preserves the name x, y, and then also the length of the list, which is 3 and 2. Okay, so we have shortcuts. There are a few shortcuts that we can use with the dot f in order to save a little typing. And then here we have to imagine if we want to fit a linear model to each group in a data set. So the following example here can split the empty cars. Remember the empty cars, data set into 3 pieces, one for each value of cylinder, and then fit the linear model to each piece. Now, what they are doing here is we have the model, which is what we are trying to perform. And then we have the empty cars. Then we have the split. This here, what this here is doing is splitting. I can say the levels of this cylinder. Now this cylinder has, I think, 3 levels, and then it's splitting it into each of those levels, and then it's going to carry out a linear model across the level. Let's go into the R studio to see what is happening here. Okay. So if you can see my screen, and if it's very clear, please let me know if it's big enough.
It's good.
All right. Okay. So here we are. So this is this. So if I run this. Okay, so see the same thing. I want to show us what is happening within here. Coming. Let me see. Okay, so this is just the output. Intercept. Yes. So we can see that we have 3 sets of outputs for the linear model. And then we have 3 sets of outputs because this splitting here, is splitting the cylinder into, let me see if I can introduce something here. Okay. Okay, data. Can't remember whether. Not sure. That's going to. Okay, so this is a cylinder. And then we can see here we have 6, we have 4, and then we have 8. I think those are the 3 levels we have there. Yeah. So we have 6, we have 4, we have 8. So it's what it's going to do is that it's splitting, is removing all the 6 separately, is removing all the 4 separately, and then it's removing all the 8 separately, and then it's performing a linear model. It's performing a linear model. It's performing, so it's splitting this, and then it's performing a linear model of MPG against WT. So we have MPG against this, but it's using this to split it. So we have MPG against this that are just, that should be maybe Mazda alone, and then MPG against WT, then we have 4. 4 is, so it's going to pick Datsun, Mercedes, this, all 4, and then it's going to perform MPG against WT. And then for the 8, it's going to do the same. That's why we're having it. That's why you're having the model coming out in 3 different groups. So we have 4, and then we have 6, and then we have 8. So that's what the splitting here does. So we can actually split. Let me see. We can actually split if we have unique values. So one thing we can do here is if you have any other level, okay, this is going down rather than going, okay, let's see this. So here is 3, 4, 5. So if you put gear here, then we can have, then we can do the same just to see what split is doing. Okay, let's see if that's going to do. Okay, so we have, so we would see the levels inside gear now. So we have 3, 4, 5. So 3, 4, 5. So that's what that's all about. Okay, so now I can go on. Let me go back to the book. So that's what is going to happen here if we run. Okay. Can you see the screen now?
Yes, I can.
Okay. So that's what is going to happen here. So ditto for this place. But there's a caveat here. Here, the dot has been used as a pronoun. So it refers to the current list element in the same that I refer to the current index in the for loop. So so it's just trying to reduce the number of writing and typing, but it's the same way where it's the same idea whereby we perform the index across a certain function within a particular data frame. It's still the same notion that this dot is being given attention to in that section. So when we are looking at the models, at many models, we might want to extract a summary statistic like the R squared. And then to do that, we need to first run the summary and then extract the components called R dot squared. We could do that using the shorthand for anonymous function. So here we have the model, the map, which here, then the summary, then we are now calling the R squared. So it's going to bring the R squared for the 4, 6, 8, which shows the strength of the model, which shows the strength of the model. Okay, so, but by extracting named components is a common operation. So POP provides an even shorter shortcut whereby we can use a string. So rather than doing this style dot, and then adding it to the R squared, because this dot here now stands as the as the data which we are working with. So rather than doing all this long process, you can just make it a string and then call it r.squared, and then it's still going to perform the same operation. We can also use integer to select elements by position. So here x is piped, and then we have a map double vector, and then position 2, which is going to give us 2, 5, and 8. And then since it's a list, then there is a way we can also, if we just want to bring in this first list, there is a way we can write it from here. That's from the vector section. I think we'll put maybe a square bracket, a double square bracket or something like that. Okay, base R. If you are familiar with the applied family of functions in base R, you might have noticed some similarities to the pure functions. You have the Laplace, which is also basically identical to the map function, except that the map function here is consistent with all the other functions in pure R. And then we can use the shortcuts for dot F. Base supply here is a wrapper around Laplace. Fortunately, I've not used this before. It automatically simplifies the output. This is useful for interactive work, but it's problematic in a function because we never know what sort of output you get. So we have X here, we have a list, and then X1, X, we have a list. Then we have a function here, threshold, carrying another function, X. Then we have a cutoff, and then we have all this. Then we are having X to do S apply, now bringing in the function threshold, and then into this structure. Here we have a list of 3, and then number 0.9, then this and this. So I'm not so familiar with that function, but I can see what is happening here. Okay, so V apply is a safe alternative to S apply because you supply an additional argument that defines the type. The only problem with this V apply is that it's a lot of typing. No, okay, DF is numeric, logical is equivalent to, and this is equivalent to this. So we can see that in terms of parsimony or in terms of being concise, this map function looks advantageous. However, one advantage of V apply over pop function is that it can also produce matrices, whereas the map functions only ever produces vectors. Okay, we have exercises here. Write codes that uses one of the map functions to compute the mean of every column in empty cars. I think this should be straightforward, but maybe let's try and see one or two before we move on. Let's see one or two solutions before we move on. Okay. We can see my screen for the solutions, right?
Yes, I can.
Okay.
I'm also viewing the book on my end too, so it's fine.
Oh, okay. Okay, so so this is the first exercise. Mm-hmm. Marlena, hope this is also visible from your end.
I think Marlena has dropped off, so it's just myself and you.
Oh, okay. So here we have to calculate the mean of every column. You should apply the mean function to each column, which is basically straightforward. Map DBL, that's a double vector, empty cars, comma mean, and then we have this. I mean, this makes life very easy, only that it comes out as vectors. Okay, so we have that in just one line of code. Now, to calculate the type of every column in this NC flight, You just apply the function type of, and then we have what we want. So map character, because yeah, here we are looking for type, map character this, and then type of, then we have year, month, day, no, etc. Now the third one says compute the number of unique values in each column of iris. I'm not sure, are you familiar with this data? Iris, the data they use in data science, blah blah blah. So are you familiar with it?
Yeah, I think I've actually tried it before.
Oh, okay.
I kind of content though.
Okay.
It was
petal. Sepal. Yeah, exactly. So here we have to look for the number of unique values in each column. So the function ndistinct calculates the number of unique values in each column in a vector. So we have map integer, iris ndistinct. So we have sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width species, which this makes it very, very easy. Okay, so let's see number four. Number four is generate 10 random normals for each population, minus 10, 0, 10, 100. Okay. So to generate 10 random numbers for each of these, the result is a list of numeric vectors. So what we have is a map, I think concatenating minus 10, 0, 10, 100, then R norm, n is equals to 10, mean. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Random normals. Okay. Since a single cell called R norm returns a numeric vector with a length greater than 1, we cannot use this, okay? Which requires a function to return a numeric vector that is only length 1. Map function passes any additional argument to the function being called. Okay, not really clear about this, but we can always go over to check.
We can actually look at that exercise 21.5.4. So I guess when we get there,
it's
a bit more context.
Okay.
But I would like to actually go on with the class itself, so at least we can finish.
Oh, okay. Finish
the class itself, then we can come back to 21.5.4.
Oh, okay. So dealing with failure, so when we use map functions to repeat many operations, the chances are much higher than some would fail. And when this happens, you know, we get an error and then no output. This becomes very annoying. So how do we deal with this? In this section, we'll learn how to deal with situations with a new function using safely function. You know, it's an adverb. And then it takes a function, a verb, and returns a modified version. In this case, the modified function would never throw an error. So this is just like cushioning out the error and then still preserve what is being done. Instead, it always returns a list with two elements, the result, which is the original result. If there was an error, then this would be null. Error is an error object. If the operation was successful, this would be null. So we might be familiar with try function in base R, which is also similar. So let's illustrate this with a simple example, log. So here we have safe log as a function, safely log. Then here, safe log 10. So list of 2 returns the norm 2.3, error null. Okay. Second one, safe log A, list of 2, results null, error. List of 2, then the message character non-numeric argument mathematical function, and I think this is a bit clear why this is not going to return a log, because this is not numeric. Okay, so when the function succeeds, the results element contains the result and the error element is null, the way we have it here. And then when the function fails, the result element is null and the error contains an error object. Okay. Safely is designed to work with map. So if we have this X, and then we have a list of 1, 10, and A, and then we have X to map the log of this Y. So we have a list of 3. So list of 2 will return values without errors. However, the last one is going to give us, the last one should be an error, which is going to give a result null. And then the error is a list of within the list of two. And the message is, because it's non-numeric, and then you can apply it to mathematical function, etc., etc. Excuse me. Okay, so this would be easier to work with if you had two lists. One of all the errors and one of all the outputs. That's easy to get with poor R transpose. So here you have Y transpose. So the list of three, num, then null. So we know here is where the error is. For the error, null, then you have list of two. So this is just in a way of making it concise. And then quickly we can see where the error is. And then we have the message telling us what the error is all about. So it's up to you. It's up to us to know how to deal with errors. But typically, we'd either look at the values of X and Y. We either look at the value of X where Y is an error, or work with the values of Y that, you know, that is already okay. So is okay. Y, then error, then logical is null. X is okay. Then here A, Y is okay. Flatten. Okay, so they are bringing, it's okay. This is another function. Now, I can't really remember what, I think I watched the YouTube and then a statement was made about this flatten, but I can't really remember now. Okay, so poor provides two useful adverbs, the safely and the possibly. And this always succeeds. So it's simpler than safely because that's the possibly, because you give it a default value to return when there is an error. So list of this now. This is a list rather, X is a list of this. And then you have double vector, possibly log. Then we are saying it should give us this as the output if there is an error. So we have the log of 1, the log of 10, and then this cannot be possible. So we have NA. So this argument here is to tell us not applicable if there is an error. We also have quietly. So these are just ways through which we don't get an absolute error for the entire process, but in a way, we are reducing the level of error that is coming out from the analysis. So quietly performs a similar route to safely, but instead of capturing the error, it captures printed outputs, messages, and warnings. So we have X as a list of two, and then we are asking it to do the log quietly. So list of two, then we have this output, results, num, zero, output, character, message, warnings, and the message. So the result here, number, not a number. And then the output, not a number produced. So everything that is just been done here are ways through which we can deal with failures within our code. And then we have safely, we have quietly, we have, we talked about transpose, then possibly. So these are some of the things we can put into practice as we progress in, you know, using iteration functions and the likes. We can also map over multiple arguments. So far we've mapped along a single output, but often we have multiple, you know, related inputs to work with, you know, and that's the job of map2 and pmap functions. For example, we can imagine we want to simulate some random normals with different means. What is expected is that we do the map. So here we have a list of 3, 5, 10, and minus 3. And then we have map random normals, n is equals to 5. And then here is the list of 3, 1 to 5. N is equals to 5, 1 to 5, and then we have this. Then for the second one, we have this. For the third one, we have this. So what if you also want to vary the standard deviation? One way to do that would be to iterate over the indices and index into vectors of means and standard deviation. So we could bring in this and then sequence along. We learned about this last week. Sequence along MU, and then map the normal, random normals, which is still the same 5, then mu. This now is saying it should work with each of them, if I'm not mistaken. That's why we have the double square bracket. It should work with each of them. And then this sigma, I don't know what the sigma is suggesting, but the double bracket is saying it should pick each of them, you know, individually, and then should return the output. So here we have the same output. We have the different output for each of them, but for we have different output for each of them for the operation that it was asked to perform, which I think is standard deviation. But that obfuscates the intent of the code. Instead, we could use map 2, which iterates over two vectors in parallel. So map 2, mu, sigma, r num, n is equals to 5, then we pipe it into this, and then we have our output, which makes it a bit straightforward and concise. So the gospel here is just to write our code in a concise manner, and then as much as possible, and then to make it readable and then very neat. So map 2 generates this series of functions or function calls. This is the mu, the sigma, and then map 2 can bring mu together with the sigma, together with the r num for each of the mu and each of the sigma, and then, you know, gives an output. We should also know that the arguments vary for each call. Yeah, we should also know that the arguments that vary for each call come before the function. Arguments that are the same for every call would come after. Okay, so like map and map 2 is just a wrapper around a loop. Okay, so this was something we learned last week. This here is something we learned last week, and I think they're just breaking it down to show us how these two works, you know, in real sense. Okay, so we can also imagine map 3, map 4, map 5, etc., but that would get tedious quickly. Instead, por r provides pmap, which takes a list of arguments, and then we could want to vary the mean standard deviation and number of samples. Okay, let's see how that works. So we have this 1, 2, 3 arguments. Okay, n, mu, sigma. Okay. Oh. Wonderful. Okay. So this PMAP now reduces the stress if the list becomes endless. And and we have a nice output. And this is the way the PMAP works pictorially, if we can picture that in real life. So if you don't name the elements, PMAP use up positional matching when calling the function, and that's a little fragile and makes the code harder to read. So it's better to name. It's better to name the arguments. Okay, so I think all what they are just doing now is to explain PMAP, and as soon as our code gets complicated, I think a data frame becomes a good approach, because it ensures that each column has a name. Yeah, that's true. And is the same length as all the other columns, okay? Invoking different functions. Okay, so there's one more step in complexity, as well as varying the arguments to the function. We might also want to vary the function itself. Okay, so we have run if r num, r position, I guess. And then we have the parameter list, minimum, maximum, standard deviation, lambda. So to undo this case, we might need to invoke map f parameter n is equals to 5, and then we have the output. Okay, so that's what the invoke map does, and then this is more or less like a picture of how it's performing its own operation. Okay, so I think there's a message from me here. How does it get to the list of 3? Okay, for the invoke.
Yes, exactly. So you go back to that code. Just okay. Want to understand that list of 3 itself. Like, how from the original code, I created an object f. I created an object
Okay.
parent.
Yeah.
How do I get a list of three? Like, how is my output
List of
in
three.
the list?
I
Yeah.
think it's from here. List one, list two, list three.
Oh.
Yeah.
Ah,
I think
okay,
it's from
fair. That's
there.
fine.
Yeah. Okay. So.
That's fine. Thanks.
Yeah. So, yeah. So then. Okay, so the first argument is a list of functions or character vector function names. Second argument is a list of lists, given the arguments that vary for each function. Okay. Okay. The subsequent arguments are passed on to every function. Again, you can use triple to make creating this matching pairs a little easier. So we have triple, we have this, and then we have lists here, and then we can mutate same invoke. Okay. Okay, welcome back. Okay, so that's that for invoke, and then we have walk. I think we are dealing with a lot of verbs and adjectives here. So walk is an alternative to map that you can use when you want to call a function for its side effect rather than for its return value. Here, we typically do this because we want to render output to the screen or save files to disk. The important thing is the action, not the return value. Okay, so let's see how walk is being called upon. So x is a list of three, and then walk print, okay. So walk is generally not that useful compared to walk 2 or pwalk. For example, if you had a list of plots and a vector of file names, you could use pwalk to save each file to the corresponding location on disk. Oh, let's see how that does it. So library ggplots, okay, plot this. Now we understand all this parts, okay. So if you save this as .pdf, pwalk, lists, parts, plots, gg, save, okay, path, temporary directory, okay. So I guess it's going to save path separately, and then it's going to save the plot separately in temp, okay. Path is going to be saved in the temporary directory, okay. Okay, and then it's going to save, okay, okay. If you run this in R, I don't know whether I have time, we'd see how this works, but we can check that on our own, so that I don't waste too much time. Okay, other patterns of for loops include a predicate function. Yeah, predicate function, the keep, and the discard. And then we have sum and vary. So the words keep going on and going on. And okay, here we have iris, keep is factor, and then string structure, okay, data frame, yes, factor, three levels, okay, discard, oh okay. So here is to bring in the factor, and here is to, if you want to discard the factors, okay. Okay, so this, okay. I think there's also a simpler way to do this though, but at least we have the output here as factors, and then we can also discard it. So that's pretty clear. So sum and every determine if the predicate is true for any or for all of the elements. So, okay. So here we have X, one, two, three. Then we have a list of lists here. So sum is character, true. Every is vector,
true.
Mm. Okay, for any or for all. Okay, for any or for all. Okay. Detect finds the first element where the predicate is true. Detect index returns its position. Okay, sample. Okay, detect is greater than 10, is greater than 5. Okay, so the first one, yes. Detect index is greater than 5. Oh, yeah. So this is the position, which is one. This is the number here. All right. So I think that's clear. Add while, tell while, take elements from the start or end of a vector while the predicate is true. Okay. X this, add while, 10, 6. Where is 6? Add while, take elements from start or end of a vector while the predicate is true. Okay. Greater than 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. Then tail while greater than 5. All right. So this goes from the rear. This goes from the rear. Then we have 7, 9, 8. Okay. This goes from the beginning. Okay. 10 and 6. Okay. Okay. I don't know why it's picking. Edward, take elements from the start and well, the predicate is true. Okay. I don't know whether anybody can throw more light here. Anyone want to try?
I'm also stumped. I have no idea.
Okay. Ed, yeah, while
I mean, I'm not sure either. I guess. Wait a minute. But I've never used that function before, so I'm clueless as well. I don't know.
That's okay. Tilde sign. So the tilde itself. What is it supposed to represent?
I think it's just taking everything within. Is to take everything within this frame.
Wow. Till wow. Okay. I have no idea. You can move on. We'll probably research on it later.
All right. Okay. So then we have reduce and accumulate. Sometimes we might have complex list, and then we want to reduce to a simple list by repeatedly applying a function that reduces a pair to a singleton. This is useful if you want to apply a two table. To multiple tables. For example, you might want to have a list of data frames. I want to reduce to a single data frame by joining elements together. Well, okay. So here we have list age, table name, John, age 30, sex, John, Mary, male, female, treatment, name, Mary, treatment A. So we have this table. We want to reduce full join. Join by name, joining by name. So you have to join by name, Mary, John and Mary. So we have John and Mary. Mary doesn't have age, so not applicable. John does. The character, yes, they both have gender. Then treatment, Mary shows treatment while this doesn't. Okay. Full join. This is more like okay. So, but definitely they would need to have a common a common base to join with. Okay. Or maybe you have a list of vectors. I want to find the intersect. All right. So VS. Reduce intersect. So we have 1 is common, 3 is common, then 10 is common. Okay. Reduce takes a binary function with two primary inputs and applies it repeatedly to a list until there is a single element left. Accumulate is similar, but it keeps all the interim results. You could use it to implement a cumulative sum. So we have 7, 5, this, accumulate. All right, 7. Plus 5, 12, 12, plus 10, 22. Okay, so this is more like cumulative frequency, something like that. Okay. All right, so this is just adding, is working more or less like a cumulative frequency. So it's just adding this to the next number and then giving us the output. So we have exercises. And then that's, we've come to the end of iteration. Okay, so any questions, observations? We still have about 12 minutes, I think. So,
I mean, I don't have any questions though. I'm kind of happy that we are, I think we are two chapters away from finishing the book itself. So,
yeah, so we have model and communicate.
Yep. But yeah, I mean, it's fine. I think one of the things I've kind of figured out going through these classes is, I mean, at least for me, I can't grasp all the entire elements within the class itself. I probably have to do like a deep dive after, which is why I kind of appreciate that the videos are usually recorded. So I'm fine with the way the class went. I'm sorry that I missed the last class because
I was
caught up impromptu by a different work assignment. But this is fine. This is good enough. I'm just quite happy that we are two chapters away.
Yeah.
I was going to get done with the book.
Yeah. I also intend to go over it personally from the beginning again myself. Yeah, just to go over it and then maybe get the book or something or get to get it printed or something. It's actually a fantastic book.
Yes, it is.
I can actually send you a PDF version. So I got the PDF.
Oh, I wouldn't mind.
Yeah, if you can share with me your mail address, I can share with you.
Oh, PDF. Okay. Oh, I wouldn't mind because I want to go over it on my own and then see how far I can go about.
Maria, I think you were saying something.
Yes, that I am too, how to say, going over the whole thing again, because as you said, it's a lot of new stuff and I'm using R in some extent, but only to whatever I'm doing for my analysis.
Exactly.
And there are a lot of new things that we're coming, that we're going over, but as you say, I mean, probably that's not the goal to have like everything fully explained and understand everything from the beginning. So it's very good, I think, just to stimulate our brains at this moment.
Exactly.
Yeah, but I'm very happy that we're progressing, guys. We're all
okay. Yeah, it's something. So so we're starting models next week.
I am. So I'm taking the entire model chapter, then I think Mari is taking the mini
communicate. All right, perfect. Fantastic.
Yeah.
Great.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we can call it a day.
Yes, we can.
All right.
Thank you, guys. Thank you for your time.
Thank you
very much.
Adeyemi.
Bye.
See you next week. Bye.
Yeah. Bye.